Good afternoon and welcome to our event. I'm Janet Collins, president of the Institute of Food Technologists, and I'm very pleased that you can join us here today for what we see as a very important announcement on our food traceability efforts, which we believe will help improve our food supply for years to come. For those of you who are not familiar with IFT, I wanted to take a moment to tell you a bit more about the organization and about our commitment. IFT is dedicated to advancing the science of food with the ultimate goal of contributing to a safe and abundant food supply that contributes to healthier people everywhere. It's an important mission which we'll celebrate next year for our organization over 75 years. And our nonprofit society offers more than 18,000 members in more than 100 countries. We bring together food scientists, technologists, and related professionals from academia, government, and from the food industry. We live in a complex global food system that is constantly changing to feed a growing population. Food traceability from farm to fork is a critical tool for enhancing the safety and security of a global food system. That's why we have created a new path to advance our mission through IFT's Global Food Traceability Center. This center will minimize the impact and the extent of food safety issues in the food supply, and it will also assist companies to better trace the path of food products throughout the supply chain. IFT has been a visible leader in the food traceability system for several years. In 2009, IFT delivered a milestone report to the U.S. Food and Drug Administration on the status of food product tracing in the food industry. We provided guidance for improvements and recommendations for future work. In 2010, the National Center for Food Protection and Defense provided a grant to IFT to conduct a two-year study analyzing the capabilities of technology in food product tracing. As a testament to our expertise and leadership, IFT completed a landmark report for the FDA on food product tracing pilots and as mandated by the Food Safety Modernization Act, or FSMA. So with that, I'd like to invite our staff person, Will Fisher, up to give us more information about the center. Thank you.
Thank you, Janet, and good afternoon, everyone. I am truly excited to welcome you to the official launch of the Global Food Traceability Center. Until now, there has been no single public or private entity that brings together key stakeholders in the food system to join forces on product tracing. There is no single global authoritative voice on food traceability. The Global Food Traceability Center will fill that void. Our vision, as you can see on the slide, is to become the global resource and authoritative voice on food traceability. IFT will create a focal point where industry, academia, government, foundations, and consumer groups can hold dialogue, collaborate, conduct research, adopt best practices, and implement pragmatic and actionable traceability solutions for the food system. The center will enable long-term collaboration that will provide traceability knowledge, advice, and expertise through solutions, programs, and initiatives to lead the development of a global agriculture and food traceability system. Traceability has become increasingly important. The global food supply chain today has evolved into a tangled web as companies seek more efficiency to enhance their capabilities to feed the world's growing population. While food safety problems remain rare, when they do occur, time is the enemy as public health and lives are at stake, as well as the livelihoods of industries, companies, and employees. The Global Food Traceability Center is intended to assist companies to better understand and implement ways in which to track and trace the paths of products through the food chain to improve food safety and food security and to avoid or mitigate devastating public health and economic impacts. We want to emphasize that food traceability is about more than just recalls. Being able to ascertain the origin of products, ingredients, and their attributes from the farm through food processing to retail, food service, and the consumer is growing in importance. Increasingly, public health concerns are demanding traceability, but it will be the business economic drivers that will sustain it. The center will use a collaborative approach for its work. It will develop science-based public-private partnerships that can share in the costs and benefits and offer specific assistance and expertise. The center will be a virtual organization that leverages resources of all stakeholders. An advisory council has been established prior to the launch of the center. It is composed of leaders from our investing partners as well as recognized international experts and leaders. The intention is to have the advisory council reflect the balanced perspective from all key stakeholders. The purpose of the advisory council will be to provide guidance and support to the center's management team and help ensure that the center focuses on long-term value for the agriculture and food industry and public agencies. The center will focus on food traceability research, education, standards, and technologies. The group will be undertaken by technical working groups. This will be an opportunity for all key stakeholders to participate as contributing partners. IFT is pleased to announce the following organizations who have committed as founding sponsors. Cargill, Eurofins Microbiology Laboratories, FMI Foundation, Global Cold Chain Alliance, GS1 US, International Association of Food Protection, Intertech Group, Linxo Systems, MARS, National Fisheries Institute, PepsiCo, Produce Marketing Association, University of Guelph, and Walmart. Their support and commitment is greatly appreciated, and we thank them. Creating the center with international scope will strengthen the agriculture and food industry in two ways. First, it will provide the leadership needed to improve responsiveness of industry and governments to food and agriculture-related emergencies. Second, it will foster the use of traceability and data collaboration in order to elevate the overall performance and effectiveness of agri-food businesses. It will reinforce the importance of being proactive and foresighted with regard to food safety and traceability issues. The challenge for the agriculture and food industry has been to find means to improve adoption of traceability without unnecessarily burdening companies with additional costs that does not deliver value. The center will be unique in the world and focus on the practical how as well as the what of food traceability. The center will be driven by the industry and the marketplace and guided by a mission to increase understanding and answer questions about implementation of food traceability. Based on the expressed needs and interests from stakeholders during IFT's consultation process, the center will be composed of four business platforms: research, protocols and standards, education and training, and technology transfer. Let me briefly discuss each of them in turn. Research will begin with identification and subsequent publication of knowledge about traceability and data collaboration solutions and how they can be applied in the agriculture and food sectors. This will extend from current IFT efforts regarding traceability and data collaboration and then grow to encourage and support innovations in traceability. Protocols and standards are an immediate concern for many stakeholders because of the risk that disparate technical systems and traceability guidelines and conflicting requirements are overwhelming the food system. Recognizing that global standards organizations already are making significant progress, this business area will act as a focal point for stakeholders to consider, endorse, and make use of common interoperability standards and protocols across the entire food system. The center can become a focal point for the assessment and recommendation of policies and standards in the food system. Education and training builds upon IFT's existing strength in the area of learning and knowledge transfer. Its main objective will be to develop and deliver tools, events, and information that will help inform people and organizations about food traceability. The fourth platform, technology transfer, will incorporate the availability of intellectual property and solutions developed by the center. The objective of this business will be to help incubate new ideas, encourage interoperable traceability technology solutions. With those platforms in mind, I want to announce that the Global Food Traceability Center will start its work immediately. After consultation with the Advisory Council and others, we have identified three priority projects that will begin right away. The first is to develop and deliver a food traceability best practices guidance document. This report is intended for national and international regulatory agencies and will provide an industry viewpoint on its current capabilities regarding traceability. The document will reflect industry's advice for regulators to consider and as they develop mandatory requirements and specific performance needs to enable food traceability. The second project will deliver a benchmark report on the existing international food traceability standards and regulations for major trading nations with observations concerning gaps and duplication. The intent is that this report will open an international dialogue concerning harmonization of food traceability requirements so that stakeholders in the food system can mitigate or eliminate possible conflicting needs and unnecessary costs. And the third project will be to develop and deliver food traceability courses that begin by addressing general principles of traceability. We're then going to extend this to include future courses to help organizations implement traceability systems and solutions. Content will be available via classrooms as well as online webcasts. Our stakeholders have convinced us that the overall benefits of having a recognized global authority on food traceability are clear for food businesses, for regulators, for the public at large, and for IFT and its members. Companies will receive the benefits of a go-to resource that is knowledgeable, collaborative, and unbiased regarding food traceability. Regulators will benefit from the discipline-focused dialogue and policy advice developed from the center's activities and expertise. The general public will benefit from the exploration, publication, and implementation of traceability and data collaboration practices, technologies, and products. Ultimately, the result will be improved food safety and security and increased transparency about how food is grown, processed, and how it's delivered. For IFT members, the center will provide the means by which they can increase their understanding of traceability in a collaborative, science-based forum. However, rather than listen to me explain the benefits, I want you to hear directly from some of our stakeholders here today. I am very pleased to have with us four key stakeholders, each one who represents a group with strong interests in food traceability. Sherri McGarry, Senior Advisor, Office of Foods, U.S. Food and Drug Administration, will talk about the FDA's interest and plans related to product tracing. Jack Sinclair, Executive Vice President of the Grocery Division with Walmart, will provide a food industry and retailer perspective. Caroline Smith DeWaal, Director of the Food Safety Program at the Center for Science and the Public Interest, will talk about consumers' interests and traceability benefits. And giving a global perspective, Artavazd Hakobyan with the Global Food Safety Partnership at the World Bank. Thank you for all of your participation today and your support of the center. I'm now going to turn the podium over to Sherri McGarry, who will be followed in turn by the other three. Sherri?
Thank you, Will. I'm very excited to be here today, and I very much appreciate the invitation by IFT to the launch of the center. It's, again, very exciting time and event for IFT and the sponsors and partners that are going to be joining in on the center's activities. I want to give the FDA perspective on the benefits from improving product tracing. And I think, as you know, we're a public health agency, and what we firmly believe and see in improving product tracing is benefits to public health. We all know, I think, that the significance of the burden of foodborne illness is more than we'd like to see, and we want to reduce that. And obviously, with improving product tracing, we can reduce illnesses, we can make a dent in these numbers and benefit our consumers by more rapidly tracing products in the supply chain, finding the source of that potential contamination and removing it quickly so we reduce illnesses and prevent illnesses. Technology has been improving over the years. We're able to detect foodborne disease earlier than we ever were able to before. Let's harness some of that information, some of that technology, and also use it to improve product tracing. I think that's a lot about what IFT is about, technology and scientific expertise, sound science-based systems, and we also want to apply those tools and technologies as we try to enhance product tracing. Certainly, industry is key to making these improvements in product tracing, but they can't do it alone. It's got to be a partnership between government, industry, consumer groups, academia, state government, federal government, all of us working together as food safety partners And I think the center, in their vision, is seeing that how important that collaboration is among the food safety partners and how we can be more effective by working together. And I think, too, as we look at advancing product tracing and making improvements so we can more rapidly find that source of contamination when it happens and preventing additional illnesses, we're also looking at ways in which in the future we can prevent these types of events from occurring. So, again, product tracing and making enhancement to that not only prevents the immediate illnesses, but really can go a long way towards repeating the events of the past. Common themes that I'm seeing between the FDA Food Safety Modernization Act, our mission here at FDA, and some themes that I'm seeing in the center's approach to the Global Food Traceability Center's mission and vision is that global perspective. If you look at FDA Food Safety Modernization Act, it's very focused on not just only the domestic industry and food safety system, but the international food safety system. And I'm very pleased that the center is not only focusing domestically, but internationally. And that is, I think, going to be quite aligned with where FDA is going in implementing the Section 204, which is enhancing the tracking and tracing of food. So I mentioned the emphasis of partnerships. FDA believes it's quite necessary to improve product tracing through partnerships. And again, the center is, I think, seeing that same approach. The other approach that is quite consistent, a common theme that we're seeing, too, between FDA's approach to implementing Section 204, the tracing component of FSMA, is that farm-to-table approach. Again, it's important to go from the consumers all across the supply chain to growers, if that's applicable, to determine where the source of contamination is, to make those links in the supply chain and have the supply chain working together to improve product tracing. Again, I've mentioned the collaboration theme that I think is critical to for FDA in implementing the FDA Food Safety Modernization Act, and again, particularly since we're talking about tracing, Section 204. And it's really an exchange of ideas and using this global perspective as we find the tools that are going to help us to improve tracing, to make it more rapid, to make it more precise by using that information that we gather. And we have the conversations about how we can improve tracing. What are our challenges? How can we overcome them? How can technology help us? How can, for that additional record-keeping requirements, what additional information can we be garnering that we're not now? How can FDA improve how we ask the questions when we do have an event and we're trying to seek where that contamination may have occurred? I think what the FDA also offers to the center is a very strong focus on public health. And certainly, as the center is composed of consumer groups as well as industry who may be looking very much at the economic impacts, as I understand it from the pilots that we've worked with IFT, there are some benefits, economic benefits. FDA, as we come to the table, will certainly be focusing more on the public health benefits, but we need to be cognizant of the feasibility and practicality of establishing a more uniform product tracing system domestically and internationally for products that enter the U.S. How many of you haven't heard of Section 204? Okay, so there is maybe one person that hasn't. Section 204 of the FDA Food Safety Modernization Act certainly lays out the requirements for FDA as we go towards a proposed rulemaking and then final rule for establishing some requirements for high-risk record requirements for high-risk foods for tracking and tracing of those foods. These are some of the key requirements that I've identified, if you hopefully can see the slide pretty well. The first was pilot projects, and I want to thank IFT and as well as the partners that were involved in those pilot projects, consumer advocacy groups, academia, state government, federal government, huge support by industry across many sectors as well, particularly produce and processed food. So a lot of learnings from that. The report from that IFT provided. FDA is posted on FDA's website, and I would imagine it's still on IFT's website as well. So a lot of terrific learnings. I hope the center will utilize some of that terrific information from that very extensive pilot study and the report itself. The report to Congress is another key requirement, which we are in the process of drafting and making some good progress there. One of the things that we wanted to do was post the report on the pilots and open a docket to get some stakeholder input before we put our recommendations into the report to Congress. So that docket actually closed in July after we posted the report that IFT provided FDA, and we're reviewing those comments that we've received. Some terrific comments do cover the gamut, quite frankly, as you might expect from the varied stakeholders. The next step that we're looking at are kind of a little bit in sync, but not completely completely tied to each other with respect to steps that we take right now, and that is the designation of high-risk foods, which will be the additional record-keeping requirements that will be what it applies to, and then, of course, the proposed rule itself. We are interested in gathering information from all of our stakeholders as we go through the proposed rulemaking process. Believe the Global Traceability, the Global Food Traceability Center, I'm going to have to get that acronym going a little bit. At FDA, we're used to acronyms, but the GFTC certainly will be one of those resources that we have for the conversation that we need to have as we develop proposed rulemaking. So we, again, will engage all our stakeholders. We see the Global Food Traceability Center as a venue for some of those conversations, as it covers many food sectors, not just one, and it certainly appears to be covering multiple levels in the food supply chain, going from farm to consumers, and that's critically important as well. And then as we move forward, of course, there will be the public meetings and opportunities for stakeholder input with the proposed rulemaking and then the final rule, and then obviously we'll be developing some more specific guidance that pairs with the rule itself. As I mentioned, the pilots were one of the very first requirements of FSMA, and if you don't know that already, it is posted again on FDA's website and IFT's. And the reason I particularly mention this, the pilot studies, is FDA has been working with IFT over the years on the topic of product tracing. We've also been engaged in many other information gathering efforts. We want to build upon the progress that we've had with IFT, and also independently as well on some efforts to gather information for our proposed rulemaking. So again, we just want to build on those efforts that we've had successes with IFT and their partners as well. In summary, I think, again, it's so important for us to improve product tracing to reap the benefits, the public health benefits that I think we're all interested in gaining. We need a more rapid and interoperable system that will not only identify some key data elements, as well as being able to link. And I think that's one of the key things that's missing right now, is that linkage across the supply chain, so we can be a little bit faster, hopefully a lot faster, and how we identify the source of a contaminated product when that event occurs, so we can remove it and reduce that risk to consumers. And again, on the global perspective, we want to have a uniform global approach to improving product tracing and establishing a uniform set of standards that will facilitate those improvements. We want to build on the preventive approach. A food contamination event may occur, but we want to reduce as many illnesses and prevent as many as we possibly can, and tracing can help us with that. I did mention earlier that there are potentially some economic benefits, and again, as FDA goes towards rulemaking, we will need to look at the feasibility and practicality, so the center and their projects will hopefully provide a resource to FDA as we go through proposed rulemaking and data sources on potential costs and benefits, and that is an area that is, I'd say, scarce with data at this point in time, because most people don't have an independent traceability system. It's part of another system, and I think we don't need to think of it solely as a traceability system. We need to think of it as the objectives that we're trying to achieve, whether it be a improved inventory management approach, things like that. So it doesn't have to be a separate traceability system, but something that achieves the objectives that we want to achieve. So as we move forward, I mentioned the requirements of FISM, and that's kind of the direction we'll be going in. Again, we do hope the and expect to work with the Global Food Traceability Center as we move forward with our proposed rulemaking to improve product tracing to benefit public health. And we are got a couple of steps in front of us as we implement FISMA and look forward to the collaboration with all of our stakeholders, including the center. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Good afternoon. On behalf of Walmart, it's a pleasure to be with you here today and to demonstrate our support as one of the founding sponsors of the IFT's new Global Food Traceability Centre. As you know, the centre is designed to be a global authoritative and scientific source of food traceability standards and solutions. And as one of the largest retailers of food in the United States and across the world, developing a global consistency for food traceability is really important to us. A centre that is authoritative, scientific and unbiased will improve the food system and help to increase confidence throughout the chain and with our customers. Walmart's goal is to provide safe, affordable food produced from sustainable sources. And we passionately believe that food traceability is a key component to continue to achieve those goals. Understanding the origins of all ingredients in the food system will make us better. And so for that reason, we're delighted to be a founding sponsor of this new Global Food Traceability Centre. Firstly, traceability is about trust. The food system needs to be trusted by all our customers. And today's food supply chain is increasingly complex and interdependent. Customers need to trust the food that they buy. Retailers need to trust their suppliers. Suppliers need to trust their suppliers. Those suppliers need to trust the growers and the producers of food, and so on and so on. At Walmart, every week, we provide over 140 million customers with thousands of different products so that we try and help those customers save some money. Those products have to be safe, affordable, and produced in a sustainable way. When our customers shop in our stores, we know they expect great prices. We know they expect fast and friendly service. But we also know that they expect and have the right to expect the products that they buy to be safe. That's why Walmart was the very first US retailer to require our food suppliers to achieve certification on one of the internationally recognized Global Food Safety Initiative benchmarked food safety systems. We believe that GFSI, as it's known, has been good for the food industry globally. But recent food scares in the US and in Europe have illustrated that problems continue. Traceability is critical during outbreak situations. It allows affected food products to be identified and quickly removed from the stores. These issues are critical. People's lives and people's health are at stake. Of lesser importance, but significant nonetheless, there are economic implications. In an appropriate abundance of caution, safe products are often removed from the chain when there are withdrawals. When they've been mistakenly implicated, which further erodes confidence of the consumer and further takes away trust and ultimately increases the cost of food. So as with the FDA, Sherri, Walmart's first priority is the safety of the food that we sell. It's much more important than anything else that we do. But there are significant implications for us doing a much better job in traceability so that we can do a better job in withdrawals. In the context, this connection between traceability and food safety is really obvious. It's critically important to be able to quickly trace the origin of food and in the ingredients in the event of any food scare. And we believe this initiative will help the industry and Walmart build trust with our customers globally. But traceability is, however, more than food safety. When it comes to food, customers expect retailers to know where the food they buy comes from and how it was produced. But retailers expect that too. In today's globally interconnected system, this is not as easy as it used to be. but sustainability, quality, and operational efficiency can all be enhanced by improved food traceability. Better traceability has the potential to help reduce the use of energy, make the supply chain more efficient, and in so doing support the objective of making food more affordable and more sustainable. By improving the visibility of where food comes from and how it travels from point to point in the distribution system, one can optimize supply chains. By better understanding all the origins of all the ingredients and all the interdependencies that exist in the food system, we can become more efficient. We're aspiring at the moment in our fresh produce business through understanding it better to create an additional day, to remove an additional day from the transport system that we in our perishable food distribution system. That gives an extra day shelf life to the consumer. That allows their food dollar to go further as the product lasts longer in their home. And it also reduces food waste in the home. It's a more sustainable way to do business, and it's a better way to do business. We've got high hopes that this initiative will help us understand all of the products we sell better, understand where they come from, and that will help us become a better business and at the same time create a better industry capable of serving customers better. Finally, it's increasingly obvious to us that traceability requires collaboration. As our global community gets smaller and more interconnected, the way we get our food from farm to fork has become increasingly complex and interdependent. If you think about it, a single food dish can contain numerous ingredients coming from a variety of different places. Think about a dish that any of you make at home and the different ingredients that it contains and the origins of where they came from. More than at any time in human history, the food system is a shared responsibility. We know growers alone can't ensure full traceability from farm to fork. We know manufacturers can't do it either. Neither can retailers, neither can regulatory officials or consumers. We can only do it together. And we believe that the IFT Global Traceability Centre will pave the way for the industry to become more collaborative as they challenge and think about these issues. That's why we're delighted today to join with the Cargill and Mars and PepsiCo and FMI, GS1, the Produce Marketing Association, and all the others that were talked about as the founding sponsors of this initiative. Working together, we believe that the Global Food Centre will help us understand food better, understand the source and origins of food better, and that will advance traceability and allow us to work together, because we can't do it alone, and working together will be the way to get better. So that's why we're supportive of this initiative. We will play our role by encouraging others to participate, share our experiences with others, learn from the experiences of others, and work with each other to strengthen the food business for millions around the world and help the food system safely and sustainably meet the increasing demand for food from the world's growing population. Thanks very much.
Good afternoon. Those of you who know me know it's really unusual for me to be up here with IFT, so I'll tell you the story. How did this happen? Well, it happened because an opinion poll actually that was done right before, well, it was within the six months before the Food Safety Modernization Act passed. One of our partners in getting that law passed, Congress, did an opinion poll that looked at many of the elements of FSMA and asked consumers what was most important to them. And some of the results came back were quite surprising. Not surprising was that consumers really believed that mandatory recall was going to be helpful to them. I think it was something around 90% of consumers supported mandatory recall. But almost on the same level was traceability. Consumers really believed that traceability was going to protect them. So the benefit As a number of the speakers have already said, the benefits really have to go both ways. Just because it's going to benefit consumer health and safety doesn't mean that it's feasible or it's going to be adopted or that FDA is going to get it through OMB or Congress or any of the other things. You really need to get this concept as a partnership and moving forward. And I think IFT has, and in driving the advisory committee process, which I served on for the pilot studies, I think IFT did a good job in really bringing all the partners together. I see a number of them in the room now, that so all sides could understand what the benefits were to them, to their community, to their stakeholders. But let me tell you about an outbreak, because every outbreak tells a story. Every outbreak is a teachable moment, and often these outbreaks show gaps. This is the spinach outbreak in 2006, and the line that drops down was consumption. I mean, spinach consumption basically fell through the floor. They couldn't sell it. You would go to restaurant chains and they would say, "We are not serving spinach." There were signs on the doors sometimes. But the story that you don't see is that the level of consumption for spinach has actually never fully recovered. The product has never come back to the consumption levels. It's close, but it's never been there. So it becomes very important for FDA to have good information so when they announce an outbreak and the cause of it, that they have the best information to target the consumer for how they can protect themselves. If FDA says spinach is causing a problem, we have a nationwide alert on spinach, this is what happens to that segment of the market. And this doesn't only harm the industry, it really does harm consumer confidence. Here are two additional outbreaks. And you can see that as the tomato and jalapeno pepper recall was happening, and we thought it was tomatoes, and maybe it was tomatoes, but at the end of it really was peppers that was causing the outbreak, you saw a 15% drop in consumer confidence in the food system. Well, that was nothing compared to what happened after the peanut butter outbreak, when really consumer confidence just really declined dramatically. So we really need a system that will help FDA and CDC to identify the cause of the outbreaks much more rapidly, so that we can reduce the numbers of illnesses, so we can reduce the number of people affected, hospitalized, and some who die. This is really the core benefit that we believe will come from an improved traceability system. And this chart basically shows that consumers' support, even after FSMA passed, really continued. 65. The blue shows that 65% of consumers strongly support traceability, with another 23% somewhat favorable. So this shows that almost 90% of consumers believe traceability is something that's going to benefit them. In fact, they're so certain of it that in a Deloitte poll in 2011, they actually tested the idea of cost. And they found that consumers are willing to pay more for food that is traceable. Now, that doesn't mean that we want a lot more cost in the food supply. As Jack said, it's very important that food be affordable. But traceability is an essential component to ensuring that this complex food supply which we all are living in at some point, whether you're the consumer, whether you're the retailer, whether you're the producer, you are at some point in this food supply, that it be understandable to the people at FDA and CDC who have the job to protect us during these outbreak events. Here are some of the data on costs that are associated with these recalls. We know that this could be a real benefit to the industry if they can avoid these costs during the recalls. But my last thought is that this system cannot be a voluntary system. The spinach outbreak showed us that one weak link can decimate an entire segment of the food supply. So it's really urgent that FDA move forward rapidly to finish the work on traceability and to create a level playing field so everyone has traceable food that can benefit both consumers and the industry. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the opportunity to speak in this opening ceremony for the Global Food Traceability Center. We at the World Bank value this partnership with the Global Food Traceability Center very much, and we appreciate this initiative and this endeavor. My name is Art Hakobyan, and I represent the Global Food Safety Partnership at the World Bank. As you know, the Global Food Safety Partnership is a public-private capacity-building partnership that supports creation of a forum where various actors can get together to discuss and to advance the issues of food safety of the global in the global food value chain. And I've heard a lot of previous speakers speaking about one of the most important aspects in now emerging global food value chain, that is collaboration and partnership. And this is what we are trying to achieve in the World Bank by bringing together all the partners in this forum. With this in mind, we value the collaboration with the IFT's Global Food Traceability Center, because we believe that this initiative may be able to fulfill a gap in terms of providing innovative ideas and results for understanding traceability issues, not only in developed countries, but also for developing countries. As many of you know, GFSP, Global Food Safety Partnership, has a participatory governance structure, and we're very, very pleased that IFT participates and that Will Fisher is a very active participant in the Food Safety Technical Working Group. Being situated at the World Bank, the Global Food Safety Partnership has the advantage of tapping World Bank's vast knowledge resources and bring additional contribution to this center and a lot of knowledge that we have accumulated throughout our work. And to illustrate this, I would like to illustrate a case study of a project where World Bank supported a creation of a traceability system in Uruguay. In 2001, World Bank responded to the foot and mouth disease outbreak in Uruguay. This outbreak devastated a country's economy. It brought down its exports of meat, which were considered one of the major exports of Uruguay, and basically turned its current account balance into a deficit. The bank-supported operation helped overcome the outbreak and the resulting epidemic through a variety of interventions, including mandatory vaccination, mandatory slaughter of animals, and among other things, instituting an animal tracking system, which was a prototype of an animal registration and identification system. Further, this system grew to become a traceability system that it traces meat from farm to the consumer. And based on this, based on this case study, I'd like to highlight four lessons learned that are common from our projects that we support when we support food traceability systems around the world. Number one lesson for the World Bank from the World Bank project is that the experience in traceability systems has been mostly related to supporting animal health, public health related interventions. Second, when successfully implemented, animal tracking systems or animal identification and registration systems become the cornerstone of the food traceability system. However, number three, it takes time to achieve the results, especially in developing countries. And number four, success is market dependent. That is, if there is no linkage with the market, there would not be economic rationale for supporting these systems, and there will not be government as well as private sector buy-in to traceability. I'd like to conclude this brief presentation saying that this case study presents our experience around the world. It's a representative of any other project that we have around the world. And this is what we are committed to bring in to the IFT's Global Food Traceability Center, this expertise and this experience. But we also are very eager and very, very interested in getting a lot out of research and all the feedback from the center in terms of global issues of food traceability. I'd like to thank you again for inviting us to speak here and to be part of this excellent initiative. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Art, and thank you to all of our speakers. Your perspectives are greatly appreciated. I love that slide, and you're going to probably see it in some of my future presentations. If that's not trademarked, I think I probably will myself. As you can see and hear, traceability affects and cuts across all key stakeholders groups, from the farm right up to the consumer. The public good delivered by a system-wide approach to data collaboration and traceability is clear. In addition, there are substantial proven commercial benefits derived from traceability. Our speakers have eloquently given their perspectives on these benefits. In conclusion, I want to say that by launching the center with international scope, IFT lends its expertise and capabilities to strengthening the agriculture and food sectors around the world, and it addresses a very real and present need. By ending on that note, we're now going to start to take questions, and we'll take questions from the room, and we also have some probably online. So we have some time left now to address the questions, and the questions can be to any of the folks up here. So we'll start with the room, and we'll go from there. Any questions from the room? And if not, then we'll start taking the ones online. Corey.
Corey Wright.
We have a mic for you.
In regards to the three top priority projects, how long do you think the first project will take to put together the best practices guide?
We've actually started on all three of the projects over the last couple of weeks to start to lay the groundwork and the foundation for those. And we're putting together development teams or working groups now for those. So we want to get them off the ground as soon as possible. Typically, when we work on research projects, they could take anywhere from a couple months to even over a year. We want to expedite both these. We want to put together some significant resources toward these right away. And I believe they can be accomplished certainly in less than a year. I would like to be able to say that we would like to have these in 6 months, might be our target. So that gives you a little idea as to the time frame. It would be more along the lines of 6 months as opposed to greater than a year.
Sounds great.
We can go to some questions online.
There's one question online that's directed for Sherri McGarry. And the question, I'll paraphrase because it's a long question, but essentially it says that you referred to farm-to-table traceability in your presentation. Does that mean that any additional record-keeping requirements would also apply to farms as per FSMA 204?
That's, of course, a very good question, and we will, of course, abide by what Congress set forth in Section 204. I think what we're trying to say is that really to achieve the ideal state of product tracing and improving product tracing so we can, again, have those public health benefits, it's best to be able to make the linkages across the supply chain from farm to table, and that whatever we can do to enhance that, to improve that, to get towards the ideal is where we want to go. But of course, we will abide by the opportunities and limitations of FSMA.
I can keep going, so.
Please do.
There are more questions on the web. Another question, a few questions along the similar theme came about, asking how companies can get involved with the center moving forward, either by providing input or serving as experts for projects or however.
Yeah, the center will definitely be open to all key stakeholders. Some have stepped up and say we would like to be a founding sponsor, and we think that's great. And we look forward to bringing on a couple other founding sponsors. The other way is to participate as an expert, to provide your knowledge and expertise. And when we start to form the work groups on each of these projects, we'll be reaching out to experts in these specific areas. And I think that's a great opportunity for someone to contribute.
Another question was, there are several industry groups that are working on traceability for their industry. So how do you see the center's work aligning with these different efforts?
I think it's going to be key, and I think, Jack, you mentioned it, that it's really all about collaboration. And by bringing these different entities into the center and having them share best practices and be willing and open to doing that, I think we'll provide benefits to everybody, to all key stakeholders across all the groups. And so we would encourage folks to do that. We know that different companies all have their own traceability systems, or at least the more significant size companies have their own traceability systems. But there's something that we can learn from each of those. And I think at the end of the day, what we're really trying to do is make sure that these systems talk to each other. And interoperability is really the key word. And that's going to be critical for dealing with regulatory agencies as well. I don't know if, Jack, if you want to...
Well, from the point of view, we're delighted the FMI are part of the founding sponsors of the initiative as well, and I know they're represented here today. I think it's very important from a retail perspective that all the retailers are engaged in this. We do have our own systems because we have to have our own systems because we're accountable for the products that we sell. But I think there's, as you said, there's great opportunities for us all to learn from one another. The great thing about the FMI as an organization is that it pulls together all retailers of all sizes, whatever the scale, and I think it will help retailers, some of the smaller retailers, to be able to participate, fully participate in this exercise as we try and get better at it.
Yes, we have a question from the room. If you could introduce yourself, we'll bring you a microphone. Just because we're getting it recorded.
Okay. Helena Bottomiller-Evich, Politico. Just changed my name. I had a quick question for Jack Sinclair. Since you are able to put these kinds of requirements on your suppliers, do you require full traceability? What are the challenges that you face when, you know, asking for those kinds of requirements?
I think there's a great willingness across the supply chain to, when you say what is the definition of full traceability, it gets very complex. So some of the, one of the charts that was up there showed quite the level of, showed the level of complexity in it. I think there's a great willingness among suppliers and retailers to truly understand the source of their products. So we don't have a lot of resistance to let's try and understand the full traceability. I think it's about increasing our level of understanding item by item, product by product. There's huge support for anything that's involved, let's make sure we're not creating any problems in the food system. I think the challenge for us is how do we learn from each other and how do we get better at it? There's been some good examples, again, that Caroline showed of where the when we take products out of the system, it's not being done as efficiently as we'd like it to be. And that's across the industry. And we are, I think, working pretty well. And this will help us get better at doing that. So we don't have a lot of resistance to this. It's I think it's just a matter of getting more understanding and getting better at it.
So do you require supply, or do you want to be working towards?
We all of our products, and there's a difference between our branded products that we sell, where they have their own responsibility to understand exactly the traceability of their products. And in terms of private brand products, we require our suppliers to be fully traceable in everything that they do in terms of where the products are made and what's in the products.
I just want to add to Jack's answer. During the tomato turned serrano pepper outbreak, CSPI, you know, we were being told that you could never get traceability down to the level of the consumer. Well, we went out and we found that most produce items have some level of traceability. There is a sticker, there is a label, and we actually brought them all here. We had our own press conference saying, guess what? We consumers are going home with these stickers. They're peeling them off. They're tomatoes. Why can't we get traceability at the level of the consumer? So I think it's helpful when Jack has traceability and Walmart and other retailers have it and the restaurant industry, but we also need to be able to communicate with consumers whether the cantaloupe or the tomato or the bag of spinach that they have is part of the recall.
If I can add.
Yes, please.
Again, communication is so critical to this, and again, the center hopefully can be a venue for those conversations. And we use the word traceability and product tracing quite often, and we're not always really speaking exactly the same language. What I say when I say product tracing and what the industry may say, we've learned through various pilot projects, isn't always exactly the same thing. And so I hope with this center we can have those conversations and also with all of our stakeholders as well, and really learning what each other means and achieving what the objective is based on a common terminology.
Yeah, using the same terms would be a great place to start. Any more in the room?
All right, we have time for one more, I think, and there are several of similar comments coming through the webcast, so I'll try and summarize them. But essentially the question is, what does the center need right now to achieve its vision and moving forward? Inclusion of small to mid-sized businesses, farming or farmer associations, what does the center need to move forward?
I think there's a couple things, and then I would like to ask each of the speakers to answer that as well, and maybe it could be what they hope would happen. There are a few links, if you will, that are still missing in the traceability chain as far as whether it be a founding sponsor or a contributing partner or on the advisory council that we're still looking for, and we're going to make that obvious to people as to where we're still looking for key players and key areas of expertise. So that's certainly important. I think once we start to identify these projects, there will be a call for experts to participate there as well. And I'm very hopeful and very optimistic that those experts will step forward. I'd like to ask the speakers here to address that as well, and it's, I think it's a great way to end the session here today, is for each of them to state what they would like to see be part of the center that maybe they haven't heard already, or to reemphasize maybe what they've already stated. So it's a great question to end with. Artavazd, why don't you go first?
I think starting with a compilation of lessons learned from across the board of the traceability and a sort of a traceability case studies, which were successful and which were not successful, would be a good start. And I think you have already initiated this as part of your program.
This is Caroline Smith DeWaal. I'd really like to see the center communicate very openly with FDA, capture what FDA needs to actually implement the law as rapidly as possible, and help fill those information gaps. I think the pilot study went part of the way there, but FDA has, you know, a lot of steps in front of it before we have a system that I think we're all gonna feel we can rely on.
Hey, I'm optimistic for what the center can achieve, and I'm really excited about it. I think one of the things is I would encourage as many other people to get involved as they possibly can. I think it's important that the expertise that exists in the food industry brings itself forward and puts itself forward to try and contribute to making things better. Ultimately, I would hope that the industry would recognize that this is a very non-competitive issue, that this is about consumer trust and consumer confidence, and that when one of us falls, all of us falls. And some of the actions, some of the things that have happened in the previous few years have actually taken some confidence away from the consumer. My aspiration and my optimism for this would be that the consumer confidence and trust would be in a very different place in a few years' time because of that.
I'd say two primary things that FDA would be looking from the center, and one is that, as I mentioned, we want to engage all of our stakeholders, and certainly would see the center as one venue, an important venue for that conversation, improving product tracing. And then secondly, as a resource, as Caroline mentioned, I think some of the projects and the expertise that's brought to the table in the center will do a lot in informing FDA as we move forward for proposed rulemaking. So I think that's as a resource is an important point of the center, and maybe they'll even have a link to the FDA product tracing page on the way. So.
Great. Well, I think this does wrap up our Q&A session. We promised to hold everybody to an hour, and I think we're right at an hour. I would encourage you to check out the center's website. A new website, which is globalfoodtraceability.org. And then finally, I want to again thank our founding sponsors for their support and commitment, as well as our presenters today. And I'd like to give our presenters a round of applause one final time. And I want to thank all of you for coming. And I know there's a lot of founding sponsors and folks that are on the advisory council that are here today. So thank you very much for taking time out of your busy schedule to join us today as well. Thank you.